ना वॉक भाई यार
और ना गाड़ी की तीरी थी
कुंत
कुंत
का
और ना कुकर
कुंत कड़ा Take your photo.
Fairly simple, although they look complicated. And they're based on some assumptions that could actually be questioned. Matteo Leone is one of the few people who make their living really worrying about the details of the profile shape and trying to model them explicitly. One does this by getting all the physics right and really expanding the relatively limited worldview that we have as crystallographers. We assume we have these crystals where all unit cells are the same, but real materials are more complicated than that. So it requires extra thinking, extra physics, development of computer codes to make the physics model our data. So Matteo is out at the frontiers of advancing our science. In addition, he contributes back to the science, role that I particularly enjoy. This is giving courses in Senegal and helping to set up a diffractometer in this small country in West Africa. He also contributes to the science by currently serving as the chairman of the board of directors of the International Center for Diffraction Data. And I particularly enjoy his expert input and trying to help the database organization meet the needs of its customers. See, our title is Total Scattering of Chaotic and Statistical Microstructure with Traditional Tools. I'm pretty convinced that he's going to convince us by the end of the lecture that there's much more information in our data than we thought there was, and perhaps that we shouldn't throw it away. Matteo?
Nice introduction to much. It's good to have friends. That's why they give this nice moment. Of course, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the possibility of talking here, especially at this time because it's also at 6, not just room 6 and lecture 6. And it's not a good time to do it. So you see, my title was quite tough. At the beginning, I tried to decide, what should I say? Let's try to throw a big stone at it. If I want to talk about something, let's try to use some word that a lot of people use. And the word is total scattering. And what is total scattering? If you try to see in books, or also as the kids do right now, browsing through the internet, to see that total scattering is actually the use and the analysis of both the Bragg and the diffuse scattering. The point is, if you look at what is available in terms of pattern, diffraction pattern that we have, you see a multitude of different features where the 100% Bragg scattering is never observed. We never see super narrow peaks. So we always have something that is off the Bragg condition. The point is that you can have something that resembles these very narrow peaks or something that is completely off, like the pattern down at the bottom, that is from an amorphous material. But you also have something in between, some very strange features appearing in the pattern with extra intensity where you don't expect to see that. The point is that the other thing that you find in the literature is that total scattering for the majority of people is this. artery fracture in the pain distribution function or the device scattering equation. This is usually the equivalence that is in the literature. The point is, somebody else using different tools to do the analysis of the same pattern, isn't it? In any case, doing total scattering analysis. And I will try to convince you that we might be able to try to do it. Of course, the total scattering seen by the two communities, the large community of the PDF and the device scattering equation, show that we have powerful tools to be able to analyze this pattern. The PDF people try to derive something from the diffraction pattern, and in particular, by handling the data, removing something that is not the coherent part of the scattering, by doing Fourier transform, they're able to derive a function called the pair distribution function that kind of give information about what is the coordination around atoms in the system. So they give a view of our system that we measure in reciprocal lattice back to the real lattice where we have our specimen. What is the problem? There's a Fourier transformation in between. And to do the Fourier transformation, of course, what you need to have is a very large cube. Otherwise, you start having truncation problem to be able to do the transformation. And whatever you do, you don't transform data. So you are never sure that what you do there is compatible with the data you measure. And it might be that you are doing some analysis there that perhaps gives some features that are not observed in the original pattern. On the other side, instead of extracting a PDF from the data, we can have also the possibility of starting an atomistic model for our specimen and build up the powder diffraction pattern using this 100 plus years old formula due to Debye that is able to give directly both the wide angle component of the powder diffraction pattern by checking the distances between atoms in our system, no matter what is the structure, but also some small angle part that in the end is related to the autocorrelation of the shape of our domains inside the system. This is a very powerful equation, but of course, you need to compute all interatomic distances to be able to get to the diffraction pattern. And when you have a small system, this is fast. When you start having a system that has a number of atoms that is comparable to a real specimen, it can be a nightmare, and it can take very long time. The point is, great techniques, you get excellent results, result in publication in top journals, but most of us has a normal diffractometer, a laboratory one. And the question is, what should we do with that? It's too short to be able to get a PDF, and if you want to analyze a reasonable size system, the Debye equation is too slow to be able to get the result. Can we get in between? So can we do total scattering analysis using tools that are not those and all the data that we have? And the answer is no. So, Jim, thank you. Actually, no, but usually, if you read the small words, I usually just give you the right meaning. Usually, is no in the general case. And I would say that it could be yes in several practical cases. It doesn't cover everything, we must be honest. But at least in practical cases, we might be able to get some information. And of course, to get this information, we need to really see what is the physics behind what we are analyzing, starting from the atom, building up some lattice, getting the grains that contain this lattice, getting a powder, diffraction pattern, and then try to work our way back on the chain. It's not easy, because in the end, this is what we measure. And we would like to have information about each of the single atoms that compose our system. It's not an easy job. The point is that if you look at the literature, everybody would swear that what Hauptmann said is the real truth, that the information contained in the diffraction pattern that we can measure is exactly the same on a typical molecular structure. So basically, having the diffraction pattern means that we have the information about the molecules. And that's true. We get the diffraction experiment on a powder, we get the structure. The question is it the information that we get the same that is contained in our specimen, or it is just information contained? obtaining the diffraction pattern. And I start pointing to the word information that also Jim mentioned briefly, because I think that the key of crystallography that is a bit underestimated is really the information content and processing the information. The point is that in reality, what we have here is not exactly the same information that we have there. And as Jim will mention it, structure usually means single crystal structure. But if you want to reproduce this powder diffraction pattern simply from the information that you have, which is structure, you see that you don't get exactly the same. You get peaks that are perhaps narrow, or you don't observe the same feature. So the information that you are extracting is not all information that is contained in the diffraction pattern. And if you want to transmit it, you start lacking something. So can we retrieve this extra information? That would be the leitmotif of my talk. And of course, everybody knows the relationship between an object and this Fourier transform, and also the nice Fourier duck examples that you can find in the internet. If you have an object and we are able to get the diffraction pattern and the complete information of the diffraction pattern, which is phase and also intensity, amplitude, in this case, we can try to have the inverse problem solved. The problem is that we measure just the intensity, so we lose information. So our diffraction pattern contains already little information. Not the complete one. In some cases, we are able to retrieve it, but it is a hard job, and it is a job for the life of several people. But from an object, we can always calculate the diffraction pattern, no matter. Even if we measure just a part of the diffraction pattern, we are not able to reconstruct the object, but if we knew the object at the beginning, we will be able to reconstruct even the partial diffraction. And this is one possible way of seeing diffraction and how we analyze the pattern. If we know the object, and if you are able to track down with some extra information what is the object that gives us the diffraction pattern, we are able somehow to try interpreting the diffraction pattern, especially if you find models for this object. Fortunately, we deal with some cases where some of the information that we have is also redundant. And the possible cases is when we have repetition of the same information in the space, so crystalline systems. If you have a look at what happens, if you take an infinite object, like the Hauptmann one, single crystal, you don't have any problem. But if you take a finite object, so finite 3D Bravais lattice, and you try to do the Fourier transform, you immediately realize that you are transferring this information that is highly contained there over an infinite space. So we do lose information. The point is that there is an encoding of the information that you have here inside the diffraction pattern that is different from different aspects of our specimen. And in particular, you can see that the lattice encodes for an infinite lattice. But the shape of our object and the fact that we have a finite Bravais lattice is something that is encoded in several points in the reciprocal lattice. And each single point bears this information, which means that here, if you take one of those points, we might be able to extract information about the shape, even if we don't know what the structure is. And it is already something, which means that there is some information that we might be able to extract, even if we don't know which kind of material or specimen or structure we're talking about. And we can calculate in closed form, in some cases, what is also the shape of this point in reciprocal lattice once we know the shape of the object, which is also good. If you're able to model our system, we are able to obtain that. But we're not working with a single object. We're working with a powder. If you take a powder and all the grains are the same, it's still no problem. You have the same information about the single crystal, if they are oriented in the same way, that is mapped exactly on the same pattern. And of course, from a single point, if you do the Fourier transform, you can retrieve the shape. This is what people doing coherent imaging actually do. They try to reconstruct the shape from the scattering and looking at single points. And it is exactly what you might do with a powder of this type. Every grain is equally equal to the others and equally oriented. The point is that, again, we don't need to know the atomic coordinates to be able to obtain this information. Of course, you might get it, but also for something that doesn't have a structure, you might be able to extract the same information. If you start having random orientation, of course, you start seeing something that is more close to a powder pattern that you know. The point is that the powder pattern degrades some information, and in fact, nobody does structural solution like this one, because you lose the information about the position of the points. But we are not losing the information about the shape of the points. You can still retrieve it if you assume that all the grains have the same shape. So you see that you have different degradation of the type of information. Even if you degrade the information on the structure, you can still preserve information about the microstructure. Actually, what may happen is this, that the grains are not the same shape. And here the problems start to occur, because of course, this is a real or a realistic specimen where we have a lot of grains with different shape. And in that case, what we have here is again something that is a complete superposition of all the effects. Can we go back? No. We cannot pretend to have atomic resolution of all the grains that are here, starting with highly integrated system like this one. You're not able to separate the information. So this is the big problem. We can get a statistical result. And the question is, what is this statistical result worth? Is it something that we would like, or is something that is completely different from the specimen we have? Actually, this is what you may have in the general case. Total orientation of the crystal, different shapes, slightly different features inside the grains, and we measure just one direction inside this one. That's why when people talk about powder diffraction and you start explaining that, they say, you are crazy. You want to extract information about the 3D structure of a system from a 1D thing that is completely integrated. No way. That's why we've got good scientists that work. So the point is that if you want to go back, we have to provide extra information. And this, again, information is the key. So if you start from the powder, and we start looking at which kind of information we need, we see that crystallography provides some of this information. Of course, phase group, asymmetric unit, thermal parameter, this stuff here that is typical of the infinite single crystal is something that with theories that have been developed can be drawn down to few numbers. So the few numbers are able to encode information about a huge number of atoms in a single crystal. Here we have the powder. We need something extra. And in fact, you need also some information to be able to retrieve the information that, about your powder. You need to add your information. And of course, adding the information about the single grain will be adding too much, considering that we measure a limited number of points. The only thing you can do is to try to get some distributions, so talk about statistics. And what do you obtain from that? You try to get out the smallest number of parameters that has a physical meaning and that are able somehow to preserve the maximum information in the pattern. So you are able kind of get back and reconstruct what you measure. The point is that what you get here is not information about the initial power, but is information about a statistical equivalent object, as I try to call it. What does it mean? If you take the set of all possible grain shapes and defects and configuration that you have, and you try to see what your specimen is just a subset, and your specimen is subset S. You do the measurement, you try extracting information, so you try somehow to be able to have this, which is a subset of the same space of grains, but in that case, to contain the information, you make some simplifying hypotheses, for instance, brown grains. So what you obtain is not exactly the information about your original specimen, but a proxy, something that is similar to the original specimen. that somehow is similar to what we do with file compression or image compression. With file compression, we try to preserve the whole information. It would be tough here. With image compression, a JPEG is something that visually is the same, but is much smaller, so you lost part of the initial information. And this is what we do with diffraction when we start putting some models. We obtain something whose information content might be different from the one that is exactly in the pattern, but is the smallest realistic system that is able somehow to describe the same diffraction pattern. What you need to maximize is this area here. Try not to be in the case where you want to have single atoms and use an atomistic description of your crystal to model something that is completely different. It might be in the case where what you obtain is some specimen that matches the data but has nothing to do with the original one. So does it behave in the same way? That's the question. We need to keep the thing simple but not unphysical. So if you want to build up a diffraction pattern starting from the atoms and try to get the dark part, not starting from the data, but starting from the specimen, you need to consider the lattice, you need to consider electron density, you need to consider the fact that you have finite domains, but of course you need to be also smart in how you put those things together. Trying to preserve entire atoms in the system and realizing that in some cases you can use some stuff like shape like this one, round domain shape, that would say, I don't have round crystal because I have atomistic round crystals, but if you apply this one to the lattice and then you put the atoms in the lattice, you obtain something that is atomistically rough. So little details can play a huge role in getting the physics in the system to be able to build up the diffraction part. So is there only size and shape in the crystal? Probably not, but we know that given the object, putting all the atoms in, trying to work out the reciprocal lattice, and then we can look at this one. If you're able to do it, we can get also a powder pattern. But if you have a look at a single point in the reciprocal lattice, we can see that each single point is a shape that depends on the object, but that is also influenced about what is the perfectness of the lattice, because of course, if the lattice moves a little bit in several directions, you smear the intensity along the various directions in the space. And it is possible to see that the shape of this point, each single point, is a convolution of effects, where you have the microstructure, that can be the size, it can be also local distortion, there is the instrument, only to be considered together. And the big problem is convolution. But again, if you take this one in reciprocal lattice and you do the Fourier transform of a single point, convolution transform is a product. And if you're able to work in real space where you have your microstructure effect, you're able to reconstruct what it is, the possible scattering, the shape of the point, simply by doing a product of function. It's much easier to handle. So we can generate a pattern for a statistical ensemble of grains simply by summing up all the system analytically or just summing up the diffraction pattern. So the information is in the pattern. We just need the model to be able to take it out. We have done it for several possible broadening sources, so several possible microstructural features, not just the size and the possible shape. Well, the grains, I don't want to enter into the maths. That would take ages. Just that the peak profiles you observe in the diffraction pattern of a grain of a certain shape is just a big Fourier transform. Is it one of the functions that we usually use to model the pattern? No. You can demonstrate that none of them has a physical meaning if you track down to a real system of grains. But what you have is that this function here is the one that you transform. It's actually the product of functions that have a certain trend with HKL, so depending on which point you're playing with, we have a powder pattern, so we have the directional information encoded there, big advantage, I would say. And it is done in such a way that if you have other effects, you can simply put them in the chain. So it's easy. We've been working out for a lot of systems, and each single term can be tracked down to a physical model for your specimen, which is not bad. Does it work? Because usually this is the question. How do you pretend to have atomic resolution with something where you are putting the atoms aside and say it's an average system with a shape function? It actually seems to work quite well. We generated some spheres, atomistically rough, calculated the diffraction pattern using the device scattering equation that gave the exact diffraction pattern, and do the same model using the WPPM approach, so convolving all the effects that were calculated analytically. And you see the match is quite good. So you don't see this kind of atomistic need, even if it is inside. If you don't put it, you don't see the ripples in the diffraction pattern. So you're modeling something physical using a very fast algorithm that scales with the number of peaks, not anymore with the number of grains. And that could be a saving of time. So you don't even always need to get every single atom, so a lot of information, to compress information about it. Be careful, because you can also work out the number of atoms from wide angle or small angle, remembering that if you do the calculation with the Debye equation, what you get a small angle is not the small angle, but this is simply the autocorrelation of your domain size. So it is something that is related to kind of a gas of particles. And we all know that usually the small angle scattering part is different because we have a real specimen with certain distances between the atoms. And the problem is that if you use this approach, you can simply take this one off because it was added a posteriori and simply put in the right one that you observe. So you can simultaneously account for small angle and wide angle in your pattern and fit together the two. So adding extra information means adding extra model. We see that we can also get some stable result simply by adding this extra information. But again, we put something in to get something else out. Being able to extract the whole information without doing that would be nearly impossible. And here, for instance, the smoothness of the size distribution function chosen as a log normal is the one that is able to ensure that you are able to reconstruct the information. Without that one, you will see a huge peak here because you will have correlation between the background and what you see there. You see that the peaks are quite broad at the beginning, down to the tails, and this will correlate with the background. Not be able to extract the correct size information. So in some cases, the information you put that is realistic help extracting something. You can also add some extra stuff that is not there. It is hard to consider, like thermal effects. The bivalent factor is the one we always consider, but we always forget to add the thermal diffuse scattering. The whole community working on diffuse scattering says, oh, it's obvious that I need to add this. But for the powder community, it's not obvious that this one is peaking under the Bragg peaks and is eating some of the intensity that you have there. And this one changed a lot given the phonon distribution there and the size of the domains. So it is something that is quite weird, but you should be considered. Is it easy to put in? Again, if you're able to put the model in, you can get the information out by considering it in the diffraction. We must remember to do the things right. So in some cases, we get to the last point with the correct models, and then we use the wrong tools or the wrong last mile. And the typical example is trying to force the Rippe model to work on those systems. The Rippe model is something that usually gives you peaks modeling to theta space. And you assume that the peaks you swear are symmetrical to theta space. Actually, you can see that peaks should be symmetrical and reciprocal. The two theta spaces, not the reciprocal lattice. There's a non-linear remapping between the two. And this model linearity, the peaks are broad, results in apparent shift of the peaks. And in fact, if you take a nanomaterial and you get the diffraction pattern, and you try to fit it peak by peak, you see a trend, always. And the smaller the domains, the stronger the trend. But this is a fake trend. It's just because you're using the wrong model to extract information from the data. So we need to use models. We need to use simple one, but we need not to oversimplify, even if you say, I don't care about that information. Even if you don't care, you might get wrong physics out of it. And with the RIPFET, we usually assume that there's one unit cell it will result in a fake specimen displacement, so a wrong cell parameter, basically, for all the system. Can we get information out? Yes. In simple cases, it's possible to do. I keep insisting, not in the general one, but in the simple case of nanomaterials, you can get information about size distribution, you can get information about shape, if it is wrong or not. You can get information about defects in the system, and you see good agreement also with other techniques. You can also have information about local effects, like the relaxation of the surface. That is something that you expect to see in nanomaterials. If you put the model in, somehow you are able to get an even better fit. But you see, you are trying to add some extra physics to the system and see that, again, compare with different techniques, you get something out. And also this comparison with other techniques, try to be sure that what you're doing is also compatible with something else, is also the key to get real or realistic result of the data. You can also work with very small peaks and with synchrotron data. This is silicon nanocrystalline and oxycarbide glass. We have done some in situ heating of the system, trying to get growth of those crystals. If you grow the crystal, depending on the size, you will see emission and cold emission from the silicon nanocrystals. And you can see that if you do the things right, you are able to correlate the size distribution with the photoluminescence of the system. So you are able to link again something that you extract from diffraction with something that you extract with another technique. That working with approximate or average things, like with an average size, you will not be able to understand why your particles are giving a broad spectrum of emission and not a single line, as you would swear if you get an average crystal size, for instance. Every single particle counts. The point is, I've shown you some cases where somehow we introduce some statistics in the microstructure, but I was cheating. Because in all cases, I preserved the statistics, and I also preserved the lattice. And if you notice, I kept saying that, okay, you can do it even forgetting the lattice, but having the lattice is a big convenience, because of course, you know already where to expect to find the Bragg maxima. And if you know where the Bragg maxima are, you're also having some sort of pinpoint where you can attach your extra scattering, the diffuse part that I was talking about in the first line. And of course, that diffuse part that we have seen so far, it was well behaving. You have seen nicely behaving around the peaks. Doesn't mean that it is something that is just occasionally found. There's a lot of cases where it works. But there's also a lot of cases where this is not what is happening. And complex system, a layer system, that of course has a very quite large importance in the industrial field, not just in the scientific one. In that case, you might find something occurring that we didn't consider. Locally, the lattice is not anymore what we think it is. It's not anymore three-dimensionally periodic, but there's something that modifies this periodicity. We get to the limit of 2D materials, graphene, maxines, phosphines, that now are hot topic, especially the possible application that you have due to the confinement in one direction. But it's not the only case. If you see those diffraction patterns here, it is something that you can find easily, even if you're in your home. It's easy to find some phosphors in lamps. It's easy to find a zeolite, of course. You find a lot nowadays in washing products. This is fortunately something that is industrial to, I would say, highly catalytic properties. And the point is that it is a mixed zeolite, and if you don't have this diffraction pattern like this, with this extra intensity that you see between the peaks, you're not getting high catalytic activity. So usually is, I see my diffraction pattern of the big batch, it looks like that, it's okay, it doesn't look like that, I expect the properties to be bad. We know that this is due to a disorder in the zeolite, we can see it under the microscope, very local information, but how to transfer that on this one. Doing it on a single crystal and being able to see it is easy. But having just this high integrated information, Can we retrieve the stuff without using single crystal or PDF analysis? No, I don't have the slide with the node this time. I try to be proactive. I try to see how. The point is that if you start having troubles with the lattice, means that in your brain, simultaneously, you might have different lattices coexisting. And they can be such that you have a very coherent interface, meaning that you go from one to the other, and you don't notice that. Maybe you have a little bit of local strain. Why not? If you have this one, unfortunately, this does not happen anymore. You cannot easily say, I have this one, this is my reciprocal lattice, and I can easily work out all the mathematics there. I still have one thing. If I have this shape, this is replicated in every single point in the other lattice. This remains, but I don't know how the points are arranged. So I have part of the information, maybe it's not the one that structural people like, but I may have something that I observe in the pattern, like these very strange shapes that somehow will not help me trying to get the nice fit that we have seen before. Because you see, I don't have any more peaks, but I have also these bands that I need somehow to model to be able to get the information about this microstructure out. So even if I can do it, it's not given for granted that I can easily do the fit of my diffraction pattern and extend. What can I do? Easy solution is take a huge cell, put in the atoms, shuffle them. I would say not in a random way, but if I know that I have, for instance, 1D disorder, that is one of the most common one, in that case I know that I can work already with layers, and it's just a matter of shuffling the layers. In the literature you find several that try that. If you have one single layer in a large supercell, you may be able to get the equivalent of a single layer diffraction that can mimic a turbostratic type of stacking. You need to work out the maths then to eliminate some of the unwanted reflections. It will generate too much. If you put faults in a large supercell and you get the diffraction pattern, you get the one for one grain. And of course, your powder is made of several grains, not just the one. Each of them perhaps with a different stacking arrangement. So if you want to do the things right, you need to consider all of them and sum up the intensity of all the patterns. Try to think what happens if you need to do it automatically with the device scattering approach. This means that you need to generate all possible configuration, even if you assume a certain shape for your domains, but you need to get all configuration with a different stacking arrangement to be able to say, I have spun all my configuration space. And if you change the shape, you need to regenerate all the crystals. And if you put in extra defect, you need again to regenerate all the stuff. So being able to track down this to some very easy equation that give the same result is a good goal. It's not easy, because of course, again, how we compress the information. And one possibility is to find some model for building up the statistical sequence of the layers. There is the possibility of doing it, but we need to have off. Was it me? No signal. There. One possibility is to say, I find some rules in the stack. For instance, I'm able to see that the stacking, putting one layer on top of the other, depends just on what I have already layered on my system. In that case, I will be able to simplify the system and find in some machine that is able to build up the stack in a quick way with a small number of parameters. Again, we try to find the smaller number of parameters that is compatible with the specimen. The point is that this one can be quite tough. You need, again, to get in something that is statistical to be able to build up the stack. And when you start talking about statistics and stacks, you can enter again into the information. And what you can do is to try to use what information theory tells us. The information, of course, tells us that when you have something that is disordered, you're not anymore able to compress it as effectively as an ordered one. So no space group anymore for the system. We need to work with layer group graphs, but with some statistics for the stack. And again, if you try to do it with a very small number of layers, you find out that you can find system with a certain entropy, which means information. But you can find also a system that have the same entropy, but they have different configuration. Look at this, BBAA versus BABA. You can encode this in a different way. They have exactly the same entropy. So you will need to use those methods to be able to compress the information. And it happens that you need to do it if you want to work out the diffraction path, because we need to start with the powder again, try to be able to get the reciprocal lattice for the whole powder, considering what I said before, and get the diffraction pattern. What you can try to do is to start with layers, put them together, and use some, again, mathematics to do the things right, at least in 2D. And what you then do, you try to add up the layers, and you can use this tool, which is a Markov chain, which is a very simple machine that has the mathematics inside to be able to encode locally the information on a very large stream in a statistical way. And you can build up any system, and again, the parameter of the machine that is able to encode with very small number of symbols a very complex system is the one that defines a specimen. Specimen that will be different from all other specimens that you measure, because it can have a different arrangement of the grains inside. And so, again, the extra information will be different. You put all together, you get a complex equation. Again, better not to handle that. The only thing is that if you have directional disorder, the formula gets very simple. And if you get directional disorder in one direction, which is typical, observed by diffuse streaks in the diffraction pattern, the formula becomes very easy to get the intensity and reciprocal lattice along the streaks. And it depends just on the structure factor of the layers, how they assemble, the phase that you have due to the assembly of the system and the phase shifts due to the statistical arrangement of the system. And then all of these contribute to the interference matrix. And this interference is the one creating the extra intensity between graphs. A lot of mathematics, a very easy formula in the end, in a very simple case. Again, I'm not telling that I'm getting the general case. This is a very simple example, and I'm getting close to my conclusion. If you take nickel, a very simple material, very simple case to convince you that you can get the information out when you know it, we generated 1 million crystals of reasonable size. Log normal distribution of diameter, so we had to calculate each single crystal because they can have also different stacking configuration. We use a very simple machine to build up the system, saying that nickel usually is cubic FCC, but locally you can have hexagonal integral. And the different color tells us where I have the hexagonal layer inside the cubic structure. If you see here, you see the individual diffraction pattern of the single particles, so they look quite weird. You should have just a few peaks there in a non-faulted system. This is the sum. So we might say that you have some diffuse scattering there, quite a lot. And actually, this was 50% faulting rate in the system. We cannot consider anymore the system as well-behaving. Nevertheless, what you observe is that you can calculate the same stuff with that very easy formula. It takes very short time, less than 1 second, you get the whole diffraction pattern. It took just 2 months to calculate it atom by atom. So again, is it worth starting with the first thing atom by atom? Better first try to do hard some of the mathematics and see if you are in the lucky case where you can do it. Here we knew the result. And of course, we are able to retrieve it with quite high accuracy. In a real case, you can also do it. It takes more time because, of course, everybody can say that somebody is crazy to try extracting diffuse scattering information from a powder pattern without having a single crystal, it is impossible to get a single crystal of this guy. This perovskite, if you put it in the microscope, it will change phase. If you change the temperature, it changes phase. It changes the stacking configuration. There's the hydrogen that is very mobile inside, and it tends to change what is the stacking sequence, because the hydrogen can sit in the perovskite structure, and moving is simply favor the movement from one structure that is metastable, where the apical oxygen in between is in between two other apical oxygen, to this configuration that is more energetically favorable. But if the hydrogen sits there and forces this local one, of course you have it. And the specimen is simply a very bad combination of this metastable structure and the stable one stacked up statistically and giving this forest of extra peaks that with a traditional modeling you will see you would track down just to 3-5 in this region, because the perovskite cage would swear that is a very stable structure. So there are chances of making also diffuse scattering analysis and total scattering analysis, I would say, in this case, using the powder. But you must be lucky. That's the underlying thing. So getting back to the conclusion, I hope that I convinced you that there's still a lot that you can do, even with a diffraction pattern that is collected in a laboratory diffractometer. Of course, the more information you have, and the larger the cube or better pattern you have, the more you can also use other techniques and those that I've shown you at the beginning that start to be easier perhaps to spot out immediately what the problem is with the specimen. So you can analyze the data in reciprocal lattice, not just in real one, if you want. And I mean, I measure the reciprocal one, I want to be sure that that one fits. The only problem is that there is still a lot to work out concerning information. We still have to consider, are we really using the simplest tools to describe our specimen, or should we start investing in something that are simple machines that goes get into these very complex shapes? There are very simple equations behind that give a complex behavior. So probably, in the end, we will see that we will be able also to model the specimens using even simpler approaches than the one that I'm trying to convince you that could be a good one in 2017.
That's it. Okay, we have some time for questions for Matteo. Obviously, please use the microphone either in the back, or we'll get you one from up here. Okay, we have assistant back there. Stunned silence, eh? Okay.
It's seven. You can see that.
Just a question referring to the glass perovskite problem. What would you get if you would do a PEF analysis from that?
The answer is, who knows? It's not easy even to get a PDF. But of course, you just need to take that one and try to mount it in the synchrotron and do the analysis there, hoping to be able to bring the specimen from the lab to the synchrotron. You will not react or change. You will be able to get information also from the PDF. Remember that it is a powder PDF, and it is not a single crystal PDF. I hope that we'll be able to try to use those new electron microscopy techniques to be able to fix the specimen and validate that one with a real picture of the structure. Because again, what will the PDF give you more than what you get here? Because in the end, you analyze the same data. It will simply tell you, okay, your distances are correct. Perhaps in the long tail of the correlations, you see something different. But I might be able to see it even if I get the same pattern with a longer cube and analyze that. So I would say, you can try. but probably you get exactly the same information.
Okay. Thank you very much for this wonderful lecture. I have more a detailed question. In the example of nickel, you have chosen a sphere to make your model. Why you did not take an HKL object instead of the sphere?
Because it was easier.
Ah, just that. Would it change a lot if you go to shapes?
No.
No. Okay, that's
the only. The only difference is, of course.
Thank you for a lovely talk. Finding simple rules governed by a few parameters is lovely if you find the right parameters. Have you ever found a case where the same peak shape can be represented by more than one plausible model?
Easy question. I would say the single peak, yes. The problem is, if you do single peak analysis, you have a very underdetermined system. Whereas if you start adding peaks and peaks and peaks and peaks, the same information seen from different directions, of course, should kind of fit the same picture. So it is quite unlikely that you're able to find a system where you find exactly the same shape and exactly the same trend, but you have completely different models. What can happen is that, given the noise, and I must stress it, given the noise in the pattern, you are not able to tell if two very similar models with slightly different parameters can fit. But this is part also of the analysis we should always do. How big in parameter space is, how deep is the value, the minimum? So is it a real valley or is it a very shallow one? Which means that really I have several possible models.
Thank you for your talk. My question is concerning the limits of your method. To which size is reasonable to use your software? To which size of crystals?
Up or down?
Down.
Down. Good question. At a certain point, the one I can give you is what you define as crystal. Because of course, if you start reducing the size and you start having large molecules, you can be to the point where the size that you're analyzing gets one molecule inside. And I would say you can still do the analysis there. Down to 1 nanometer, I would say you get a good agreement between what you analyze using the Debye equation and what you analyze here. If, and there's the big if, you don't have a change in the crystallography. Because of course, materials have that bad tendency that when you lower the size, they might also change. And if you take precious metal, like it was where you know, you reduce the size and you start having non-crystallographic shapes, that can be a nightmare model. Because of course, if you start having decahedra or icosahedra, at that point, I would say, I don't have any size at which I can say anything. Because I'm simply changing what it is, the basics, the underlying thing. I must have a lattice or something that behaves quite well to be able to get information. But down to 1 nanometer, I don't see why you cannot do it. Distribution can also be the problem. Because of course, if the distribution is narrow, it's like having a very focused microscope. But if the distribution is very broad, then being able to distinguish the very small particles that give very broad and diffuse peaks with respect to the large one that have larger volume and narrow peak, so they will appear brighter, I would say, much better in the peak, that can be also a problem.
All right, since we all know that there are other things happening at 7 o'clock,
yep.
Seeing no great clamor, we have, as you may remember from this morning, one last bit of thank you for Matteo. So, if you're ready. tomorrow.
Hopefully.